Is it on?
Yes.
Okay, my name is Emily Sharp. Last name is S-H-A-R-P. Can I go ahead and speak?
Yes, please.
Okay. Thank you so much for holding this public forum. I wanted to introduce myself. My name is Emily Sharp, and I have been in the U District as a student and or UW employee for the past 25 years. I work at the UW Medical Center as a PT and recently worked to unionize my department due to escalating demands placed on us by UW. The UW is not the same employer that it used to be. Just this upzoning that I've heard about is just another example of that. I have many concerns about the upzoning and the master tenure plan.
Mommy got
and yeah, that did, yeah. And wonder how the UW lost their focus on being a place of learning and research. When I started working at the UW, they did not appear to be so corporate and driven by making money. The U District is a place that needs to house students and UW employees, and I wonder where the UW plans for them to go. In the plan for the, is the plan for them to be pushed out? Is that the question? The people who work and go to school here cannot afford high-rise prices and struggle to afford things they need like childcare. My example down here. When I started my family, I struggled to look for childcare. I got on many lists, including the UW one in this area. Childcare is very challenging around the U District. When I was on maternity leave and had been on the UW list for a few years, I called to inquire about childcare. And I was told that, well, we actually only place about 2% of infants, and was told to wait and hear from them. I was forced to get other more expensive childcare, and by the time I was called by UW several years later, I of course had other arrangements. I cannot imagine how much harder childcare would be to find, or would be to find if I were competing against people in the tech business or who could pay higher prices. Some UW employees spend as much as half their monthly income on childcare right now, and I'm sure the cost will only be inflated as it gets more expensive for childcare centers to be run in this area. The U District needs to be a place where students and UW employees can thrive and not a tech hub. A tech hub and high-rise rents and is not a good environment and is not appropriate for this area of town, which I suggest should be elsewhere. The UW should be focusing on preparing students for a bright future and being close to the place of learning as well as being employer of choice. The people working in the labs and graduate students should be able to afford, should be able to work and be able to start their families close to the place where they work and not have to live far away with difficult or no childcare choices. This is stressful and will impact their ability to be successful. The UW needs to take a long look at what they stand for and what is important.
Thank you.
I'm going to ask people to come forward to this microphone because there's an echo and we're having a little trouble. So, Jordan, would you mind coming up? Thank you.
Could you announce the next two speakers so people can prepare?
Yes, the next two after Jorgen are Paula Lukaszek and Annette Beignier.
I'm Jorgen Bader. I live at 6536 29th Avenue Northeast, Seattle 98115. I submitted a letter in your comment box on the master plan document. But the comments there also pertain to the draft environmental impact statement. I want to press three major themes. One of them is that the development, particularly the development of East Campus, will have a major impact on that area between 30th and 35th Avenue Northeast, between the Burke-Gilman Trail and the Calvary Cemetery. There will be increased traffic all around it, and that includes not only the East Campus development, but it includes also the doubling of the size of Blakely Village. To mitigate that, you need to contribute to sidewalks on Northeast 50th Street, south of Cemetery. That is a roadway without sidewalks now, and that is rather unhealthy for pedestrians to use. The second thing I would draw your attention to is University Slough. It is not shown on half the maps in the on the plan. It's only labeled once, but this is a very important to the like the Union Bay Natural Area. In fact, it's almost indispensable to them because it brings the fresh waters of Ravenna Creek into Union Bay. This cleanses the wetlands, it cools them, it feeds them, and it's steady in the winter time. It should be remembered that all the fingerling salmon from the watersheds of the Duwamish River, in the Duwamish, no, don't strike it, that comes from Sammamish and from Lake Washington go through that area, and this is one of the only three wetlands in which the fingerlings can live for several months while they gain the strength to go out to the ocean. The third comment relates to the Montlake, the bridge over the Montlake Cut. The SR 520 plan calls for a parallel bridge there. It is very important. Before tolls were imposed, we had backups from Montlake Bridge all the way to University Village and sometimes up to Five Corners. It would take a half an hour to cross that distance during peak hours. The SR 520 plan calls for a parallel bridge, but it is not shown in any of the maps in the master plan. There was an expert for the state who predicted that the tolls would decrease traffic by 28%. He was right on. He also predicted that the traffic flow would come up, and he's right on that, and he predicted there would be gridlock. If we did not have a parallel bridge, because there are six lanes on one side that feed into four lanes on the bridge itself, I urge you to put in comments or in the plan itself indication of the parallel bridge and also transit HOV route to, by, and that Sound Transit UW station. Thank you.
Next is Paula, followed by Annette and Taylor Ahana.
My name is Paula Wakazik. My address is 5044 35th Avenue South, Seattle. Thank you for allowing me to stay up here. I'm the president of Local 1488 Washington Federation of State Employees. I'm here to talk about housing affordability. Last night I was at the City Council budget hearings speaking in support of Kashama Sawant's Build a 1,000 Homes. Housing affordability is at a crisis here in Seattle. What it tries to do is address the low-wage workers and them needing affordable housing. And I'd like to suggest that the university look at those income levels because it really does address low-wage workers who actually work full-time but can't afford to get a place here in Seattle. There's in addition to our employees who allow low-wage employees, there's the students, there's staff like the adjunct professors who may make $15 an hour, but they only work 12 to 15 hours a week, and so they can't afford places either. Already housing is being displaced in the university district. There's high rises going up, and the prices are unaffordable for most of the students and employees. The U of Dub has gone on a housing, a dorm binge the last 2 years. They're replacing all their old dorms and building high-rise, very expensive dorms. Even the three dorms on the north side, like McMahon, McCarty, and Haggett, are slated to be demolished. And those are ones that students consider affordable. You know, and the main thing I want to bring up is, besides the housing affordability that the U of Dub, you know, has to address that issue, is also that the U of Dub has not proved itself to be a great landlord. About 2 months ago in the Seattle Times, they had an article about the $1 billion deficit in preventative maintenance, the backlog. The U of Dub has not hired enough maintenance workers, and we're questioning, are they going to be able to hire enough workers to maintain these buildings that they plan on building? These are all going to be state buildings, you know, U of Dub owned. And they need to be maintained if we're going to become a world-class university. So again, I'd like them to look at housing affordability for all income levels, and also about what are they going to do about the maintenance. Because as it is right now, they're using a lot of the maintenance money to put into new buildings. They're also using the student activity fees to fund the new dorms. And they're taking student activities fees that are designed for maintenance or earmarked for maintenance, and they're putting it into new buildings. So, you know, the U of Dub needs to address who's going to maintain all these new buildings that they, I've got 30 seconds, all right. Who's going to maintain all these buildings when they can't maintain the $1 billion backlog that they have, which is actually only on main campus? It doesn't address health science, the two hospitals, or any other areas that the university owns. Thank you.
Thank you. Next on is Annette, followed by Taylor, followed by Karen Hart.
Good evening. My name is Annette Bernier, last name B-E-R-N-I-E-R. Do you need anything else? No, okay, thank you. Thank you for this opportunity to address this public hearing on behalf of our colleagues who have 2 to 3 hour commutes per day and could not attend this evening. So I'm speaking on their behalf this evening. And I'm addressing traffic congestion problems in the U District, which will make longer commutes for UW staff and students using bus transit. Again, as I said, my name is Annette Bernier. I've worked on campus for 13 years, currently in the Department of Philosophy. Before tolling began, construction congestion and traffic became unbearable. I started riding the bus in 1988 to Seattle when I worked for Bank of America. I've worked and driven to positions in Kirkland and Renton, so I've been all over the city. And I'll retire in about 12 years, but I can't think how younger employees are going to manage with all of this congestion. I do have a story about a colleague in our department, philosophy department. She was hired, but she could not afford to move to Seattle from Tacoma. And unfortunately, that commute became so horrendous, 2 to 3 hours per day, she ultimately quit, which was most unfortunate. Our department was left again to fill the position of our graduate advisor, which left us, you know, in searching for someone yet again. I'd also like to address that there are hundreds and thousands of hours wasted in traffic every day, waiting for late buses. And as I looked at the plans in the lobby, I saw that there's going to be quite a bit of construction on Pacific. That is already a very congested area, and it's extremely frustrating. So with more construction and more employees and students on campus, the traffic will undoubtedly worsen. Can you imagine how much more productive we would be here on campus if we didn't have to spend so much time commuting? So again, I thank you for your time, and hopefully we can resolve some of these issues.
Thank you. Taylor is next, followed by Karen, followed by Lindsay Saez.
Taylor is not here, so I'm Karen.
Thank you.
All right. My name is Karen Hart. I reside at 4215 47th Avenue South. I'm the president of SEIU Local 925 and a proud member of the U District Alliance for Equity and Livability. The union represents 7,000 here at the university, and our alliance probably close to 50,000. We have serious concerns about the UW master plan. The expansion plan uses the narrowest possible definition of sustainable development in its guiding principles. Sustainable development includes environmental, social, and economic factors, including equal opportunity, poverty alleviation, and societal well-being. The plan omits any discussion of these factors, even though the U District has some of the highest percentages of people living in poverty in Seattle. And I'm including in my comments the public health map, census tract map that shows that fact from King County Health Department. The expansion plan will make housing and other costs even more expensive for low-wage workers and students. Yet the campus plan neither acknowledges this reality nor makes any attempt to mitigate these effects. U District renters are some of the most cost-burdened renters in Seattle, and I'm also including a health department map that shows that the U District census tract that is in fact the fact. The campus expansion calls for expanding the campus buildings by one-third and population by 20%, yet the university is not providing affordable housing, childcare, or transportation options for many of its current staff and students, let alone new staff trying to live in a more expensive city. The most new construction is planned for West Campus, adjacent to the high-rise buildings planned for the U District upzone, yet the plan does not clearly answer the question how this small area of neighborhood will accommodate the additional combined growth. The expansion will worsen already bad traffic, as you've heard tonight, congestion problems in the U District, making longer commutes for UW staff and students using bus transit. From the president on down, the university claims it is committed to racial justice, but nowhere does this plan acknowledge that low-wage workers of color and students of color at the UW will be affected the most by the plan, from rising rents, displacement, and even more difficulty in finding affordable, accessible childcare and transit. The UW plan for additional childcare is not adequate. Low-wage UW employees need financial support from the UW to arrange childcare in their own communities, not expensive slots on a long waiting list. The big winners from the campus expansion and the upzone will be the university's bottom line, the tech companies and their employees who can afford higher rents from new construction. The losers will be low-wage workers and students facing higher housing prices and commuting from further distances. The UW should go out of its way to meet community needs. Thank you.
Thank you. Up next is Lindsay, followed by Victoria Gift, and Matt Belinsky.
Hi, my name is Lindsay Sines. I live on 143rd and 15th Avenue Northeast, and I work for Patient Financial Services for UW Medical Center and Harborview Hospital.
Could you please spell your last name?
S-A-E-N-Z.
Thank you.
So I'm here today to talk about affordable childcare. I'm recently pregnant and expecting my first baby. I've been a taxpaying citizen my entire life. My baby's dad is passing away of cancer right now, so I will be a single mom. According to UW Medicine, I am low income and I am qualified for 100% financial assistance, so they consider me not able to pay for my co-insurances or my deductible. But as an employee, they expect me to pay $1,850 a month for childcare. That's pretty much my whole net take-home pay, and I love working for the U. You know, I'm inspired every single day. I believe the doctors are heroes, my patients are heroes, and all the students that are going to school are becoming our heroes in our community. And I don't want to have to quit to be able to take care of my child, and that's where I'm at right now. And it really sucks, so I just, you know, would like you guys to think about that. Thank you.
Thank you. Victoria, followed by Matt Belinsky and Rhonda Johnson.
All right, I'm Victoria Gift. I live in Federal Way. I work in patient financial services, and I'm here today because the housing and the transportation cost impact me greatly. I've been with UW since 2007, and in that entire time, I've never lived closer than Federal Way. In 2007, my rent in Federal Way was $750 for a two-bedroom apartment. Now it's $1,550 for a two-bedroom apartment. It takes me an average of 2.5-3 hours to to commute each day. And I can't afford to drive here. I can't afford the gas. I can't afford to pay to park. I can't afford the wear and tear on my car. I have a child who has a very serious health condition, and when I need to get home to her, if it's not peak hours, it takes me about 3 hours to get to her. I've had four instances in the last year where I have been on the phone with EMT while they were with her and she was crying for me. I at the beginning of this year, I had to hospitalize her. And when she left the hospital, she had to have three appointments a week. So I had to choose between coming to work because I can't afford to drive here for half a day, pay to park, then get home to take her to her appointments. So I had to miss a lot of work when I need to be here so that I can keep my job. I'm at a point where I have to decide, am I going to stay here where I've already put in 10 years, or do I need to move on so I can be available for my children? Because the commute, it's just, it's too much when you have to leave on short notice. So those are my two main issues, and I really think that UW needs to consider those things. When we first came to the tower in 2008, my commute took a half hour less time in the morning. It's increased by 30 minutes to get here at 6 o'clock in the morning. It takes about an hour and 20 minutes getting on the bus at 5:50. That's really early in the morning for the commute to be that bad. So, thank you.
Thank you. Matt Belinsky. Followed by Rhonda and Peggy Vitullo.
Evening. Hi, I'm Matt. Last name Belinsky, B-A-L-I-N-S-K-I. Don't use Y. So, good way to start, right? I'm just here to talk about the same things that my same coworker just brought before you. Transit and housing. But because I have a little bit more time, because I don't have a child in the hospital, I'm going to bring a couple of facts forward. In the last year alone, according to the Seattle Times, rent in Seattle has gone up 9.7%. So let me paint a picture for you this last time. At Mary Gates Hall, I talked about how the average rent in the entire Seattle encompassing area was about, what, $1,452, I believe was the exact figure. The one that I pulled this morning from the 2016 July average rent in Seattle was $2,031. Let's all take that in for a second. Who in the classified staff can actually afford that? Right now, so real clear picture. I'm a US Army vet, I was a medic in the Army. I think I make a pretty okay living. I make about $3,800 a month. That's over 50% of what my income would be. That doesn't even include getting here. I mean, I also take the 197 like my coworker right before you. I get on the 6:30, and I've timed this on multiple days across multiple weeks, and my average is right about 88 minutes. So on Sound Transit, the 197 says it's supposed to arrive when it leaves at 6:32. It's supposed to arrive at 7:30. I'm generally walking off the bus at Roosevelt, if I'm lucky, 7:50. If I'm unlucky, 8:10. And I think I have a witness who can attest to that. The takeaway that I want everyone here to get from this is that, so I was talking with a lady out there, I'm not gonna name her, but there's about 6 million square feet that's really not said to be anything right now. It's just stuff that the UW has said that they needed, with a total of about 9 million more, making an overall total of 15 million square feet. Why can't some of this be childcare? I can think of one person in the room who would agree with that. Why can't some of this be apartments? Why can't it be affordable anything to help the staff like us? There's no significant reason I can find in all the data I've done as to why it can't be. There's no reason why our employer can't help us. Much like my, again, going back to the old employee, I love working here. I work for the headache clinic, and I have seen people stop using opiates and start using natural remedies. I've seen doctors heal people. I love what I do. This is an amazing place to work. But I need to be able and enabled to work here. Thank you.
Rhonda? followed by Peggy and Scott McDonald.
Good evening. My name is Rhonda Johnson. I am SEIU's UW Chapter Vice President. I work at the UW Medical Center, and I've been a steward for SEIU for the past 8 years. One of the issues that I wanted to talk about is the commute. My commute has almost doubled in the last 8 years that I've been here. What used to be a 35 to 40 minute commute is now over 60 minutes, and that's when I have access to my vehicle to get to the park and ride to catch the bus. But I have an older vehicle, and sometimes when it breaks down, my commute is increased to about 2.5 hours each way to get to and from here. Now, I have a colleague who works swing shift. He's working from 3 to 11, and he lives on the south end. When he finishes his work day, he can't even go home because there are no buses that run that late. The buses that I catch stop running at 6 p.m., and that's with working at the medical center that's open 24 hours a day. Stops running at 6 p.m. His buses stop running before 11, so he has to go to the locker room and sleep all night until the buses start running the next day, and then he goes home and starts the whole process over again. I personally think that if the University of Washington has the money to build an up zone to increase the population here by 15,000 people, that they can use their influence to increase the buses and the light rail system and everything that the employees who work here use to get here, because it doesn't make any sense to spend an hour for what would be, for me, a 15-minute commute if I could afford to drive in. They can use their influence and their money to make the commute more logical for the employees that work here. Thank you.
Peggy, followed by Scott, followed by Eric Wall.
All right, well, public speaking is not my thing. My name is Peggy Vitullo. That's Peggy with a Y. V is in Victor, I-T-U-L-L-O. So I've lived most recently in the U District the last 16 years, so needless to say, I have a few thoughts on this. No way to avoid that this construction is going to avoid increasing rents in the neighborhood with the seven-story cap that we already have and CBRE buying up everything they can and throwing up apartment buildings. The rents are already going up. An example, 2015, September, my rent went up 12%. This year, it went up 7%. If you're familiar with the pay increases that classified staff get, you can imagine that our little 2 and 3% increases are leaving me worried about eating at the end of the month. No doubt about it, new construction west of campus will undoubtedly replace lots of older apartment buildings that are currently there. And I don't know for sure, but are probably more affordable than anything that would go up and replace them. Traffic and parking, I don't own a car, so you think I might not care about this, but literally walking to and from work every day, I place my life in danger. I really have to just assume that people are going to try to run over me. It's worse on days, for instance, when the farmer's market is in place. I live a block and a half from there, and even if I'm walking the other direction, people's frustration in trying to find parking to enjoy one of the U District's beautiful events, ignore marked crosswalks and that kind of thing. And so increased traffic, lack of parking really create problems for everyone, and I don't envy anyone with a commute. Let's see, sustainable living. Cramming more people, whether they work or live in this neighborhood, into it, it's going to be difficult to do that in a way that's actually going to increase sustainability, even to maintain whatever levels exist in this neighborhood. I think it's kind of interesting that the UW has recently announced this cross-disciplinary global health thing that's going to take into account not just medicine and disease and all those sorts of things, but economic justice, social justice, so on and so forth, so, so on and whatever. Sorry, but I told you, not a public speaker. But all these things affect quality of life. Plenty of studies out there showing that, for instance, income inequality is a serious indicator of health overall in a country's population. So we're doing this thing internationally, but nobody seems to care about it in the neighborhood that the university resides. I just find that kind of interesting, and thank you very much.
Thank you. Scott, followed by Eric, followed by Woody Sullivan.
Hey there, my name is Scott McDowell, M-C-D-O-W-E-L-L. I live at 6858 20th Avenue Northeast, just 2 miles north of here. I graduated from Nathan Hale almost 30 years ago, so I've been in this neighborhood a long time. I'm a Coug, but I know the university is a real asset for the city. It's a great university. If my son went here, I'd be proud. As the university needs to expand, I understand that, but they need to help out with us employees that work here. I am the only one in my department that does not have a commute of at least 45 minutes. In my department, not a lot of us are low income, but the people that are low income need help. I would propose that the university either raise their wages to make it a true living wage for the city, or build and subsidize childcare so that their employees can afford to have their kids in quality childcare near their work. I also feel that the university, for all these long commutes that our employees have to go through, should just make the U-Pass free for students and employees. I think it would lead to an increased utilization of mass transit, which would help with the traffic problems that are, you know, plaguing our wonderful neighborhood. I didn't have any really prepared remarks, but that's just what's on my mind, and I appreciate you taking time to hear me.
Thank you. Eric, followed by Woody, followed by Bob Hodges.
Good evening. My name is Eric Wall, W-A-A-H-L, excuse me. I live at 3825 Whitman Avenue North in Fremont. My name is Eric Wall. I'm in my sixth year as a program coordinator for UW Surplus and Facility Services, where I've handled everything from their marketing to auction sales and their website. I hold 2 graduate degrees. My husband is a science teacher, and we live in an apartment in Fremont that has seen the rent increase by $100 every year for the past 5 years, while our salaries have not measurably increased. We fully expect a much larger rent increase in November as we enter another year of living here, for which we'll have to make further cutbacks to afford. Buildings literally on all sides of us have been or are in the process of being torn down to make way for condos that start in the low 600s. For a decade, we've been scrimping and saving because we want to be able to buy a home here in the city that we love. My family sold farmland to help us try to have a sufficient down payment, and by January, we'll have saved exactly $100,000. Yet with the median home price in Seattle well over $500,000, it now seems that even with our savings and our years of living frugally, we can't afford housing in the city proper. We know we'll have to move farther away. I can't imagine the cutbacks my colleagues with children have to make to be able to live here. The first cutback I'll have to make is my UW parking permit, for which I pay over $400 per quarter. That's an expense our managers can afford because they make twice to three times what I make and more. The wage disparities between program coordinators and management here are frankly untenable. But if I had a guaranteed U-Pass as a free part of my work contract, that would be a significant first step in making things much more manageable for us. At a recent monthly crew meeting in my department, we asked our director if our building, the plant services building, would be earthquake retrofitted if extra floors are added to the structure. We were told this was not in the plan, and then he made a joke about liquefaction. If you know where our building is located, you know why this is particularly unfunny. I want our upper management to take our concerns seriously. I'd like to see something in your master plan connecting sustainability to safety maintenance of our current structures. Yes. The U District upzone and campus master plan will be amazing boons to the university, and the UW intern has a great opportunity to ensure that its hardworking staff is included in the benefits and meaningfully supported during these times of change in our city. I'm asking you to ensure we are not forgotten in this regard. Thank you.
Thank Woody, followed by Bob, followed by David West.
Hi, my name is Woody Sullivan, S-U-L-L-I-V-A-N. I'm a professor of astronomy in the astronomy department. I live at 6532 Palatine Avenue North in Seattle. Before I get into my main topic, I want to say that the point that was made about global health getting $200 million, what about health right here in Seattle? I think that's a fantastic point, which I think I'm going to send an email to the president tomorrow of the university about that. So I'm here for something entirely different, namely that some of you may know that there's a large sundial on the physics and astronomy building right on the Brook Gilman Trail where Pacific Avenue hits 15th. It looks like a green spider web up there, but it's a working sundial. It is a world-class sundial. I designed it, but I know an awful lot of people in Europe and around the world that design sundials. It's a world-class sundial. Unfortunately, the campus master plan has nothing to say about it, and is proposing the possibility of 160-foot buildings about 100 feet in front of it, which would completely put it in the shade even in the summertime. And so this is the basic problem. You can't move a sundial to another wall. It's a part of the building. It's designed specifically for the southwest orientation of the building and so forth. Building orientation, light and shadow, is a key thing that is talked about in the campus master plan, key parameter for development. A general guideline is to minimize the impact of overshadowing on existing buildings, and yet it's been ignored here. The high buildings would be in the medical side of Pacific Avenue, the South Campus zone, and a statement is made there relative to shadows that there are no existing public parks or open spaces adjacent to the South Campus. And that shadows will be cast only on existing campus areas. Well, yes, but in this particular case, casting a shadow on, and it's not only, by the way, a sundial that's there, but there is a small dome observatory in a balcony next to it that we use for undergraduate instruction. That also would be blocked off looking to the south, which is the key part for astronomy, even at nighttime. So this is just unacceptable. What I propose is that just like is done for the Theodore Jacobson Observatory, the old small observatory on the north side of campus at the north entrance, that it has what's called a high zone of sensitivity to light and blockage issues. If you look at the campus map as a whole, that there should be the same for the sundial.
Time.
And I'll be pressing for that, and thank you very much for your time.
Bob, followed by David, followed by Dom Forbush.
My name is Bob Hodges, that's spelled H-O-D-G-E-S. I live at 420 Northeast 43rd Street, Seattle, Washington, 98105. I have the privilege of speaking tonight as a representative of the 4,500 teachers, researchers, tutors, fellows, graders, represented by the United Auto Workers, Local 4121. Although we would celebrate this master plan in as much as it does contribute to a research, an improving of research at the university, we have grave, grave concerns about the master plan as published, and we stand in complete solidarity with the demands of our brothers and sisters in WFSE and SEIU. These are not side issues. Issues of housing and childcare affordability and issues of transit and the rights of our members and all people who use the U District to free mobility are essential parts of any decent conception of sustainability. So we have a strong, strong statement of solidarity. In terms of a couple specifics, So the projections I have seen, and I did have the misfortune to read the entire master plan the other morning, but the projections I have seen say that we're expecting 13,000 new students as a part of this master plan and 3,000 to 5,000 new workers in the U District at private firms and other things that will be encouraged by this master plan and the coinciding University District upzone. The qualifications in the plan to absorb this seem woefully insufficient. All the rhetoric about the transit is about maintaining current levels of transit. There seems to be no willingness for the university to do very much on that besides make a few of the streets more accessible for city buses. There seems to be no commitment to increasing service at the university for SoundLink Light Rail or for King County Metro. And likewise, the housing component seems woefully insufficient, with only 3,000 new dorm beds being proposed in the master plan and a corresponding figure of 9,000 new beds in the university, as part of the university district upzone, which, again, we have no guarantee that most of those will be affordable and available for the people who currently live in the U District community. A few other concerns I want to lay out. So the benchmark universities that are used in the master plan to compare the University of Washington's use of space for seem wholly inappropriate to me. Universities like Rutgers, the University of Michigan, the University of Texas at Austin are fine and great institutions, but they do not exist in large cities and do not have to function as good neighbors in those cities. Really, the only city on the list of comparisons that seems to at all to meet Seattle's sort of unique specifications is Johns Hopkins in Baltimore. Furthermore, we as a union demand that the university make good and solid guarantees of the accessibility of the affordable housing that will be built for international students and scholars who are some of our most important members. We also think that there needs to be serious thought given to childcare and lactation facilities in the building, setting out benchmarks and targets that all this new construction will hit. And finally, an issue that we're very concerned about is that all single-use bathrooms in these new buildings will be gender neutral, which we think would set a good and progressive benchmark going forward. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you. David, followed by Dom, followed by Richard Ellison.
Good evening, I'm David West. I live in Southeast Seattle. I'm a UW graduate. I'm here tonight representing the 20 organizations of the U District Alliance for an Equitable and Livable Community. My brief comments will focus on the environmental impact statement, and we will submit more extensive comments in the coming weeks. The draft EIS fails to consider several alternatives to expanding the Seattle campus, including shifting development to other UW campuses or creating a satellite campus, as the University of California is working on in Berkeley. Or putting high-rise development in an area that already has significant high-rise development, such as South Lake Union, or the UW's tract, the property UW owns downtown. The EIS does not analyze the cumulative impact of campus expansion, the U District upzone, and the UW's property development and leasing outside of its campus when it considers the impacts on air quality, environmental health, population, and housing in this EIS. The housing analysis is particularly inadequate, with no analysis of housing displacement or cost impacts, even though most of the new housing built will be unaffordable for many students and staff. The U District and other neighborhoods along light rail are already at high risk of displacement, according to the City of Seattle. So given all this, it's not credible to say that significant housing impacts would not be anticipated, as the EIS does. The EIS makes no effort to analyze income, race, and gender of staff and faculty, which when combined with the housing and transportation impacts would likely demonstrate a disparate impact on communities of color. In fact, the community engagement plan for this environmental impact statement shows no record of outreach whatsoever to communities of color in the Seattle area, not to mention employee organizations, childcare organizations, housing advocacy organizations, or transit advocate organizations. On transportation, the EIS offers no significant mitigation to vehicle traffic issues or transit plans, and no plans for more accessible transportation for the over 13,000 new people. The traffic analysis assumes that students and staff will continue to live in the U District, but fails to consider that more expensive housing will force people to live further away, thus changing the analysis. The EIS does not examine the impacts of possible UW plans to hike the cost of transit passes, as was proposed this year. Given all of this, the transportation analysis in the EIS is not credible. All in all, this EIS has major flaws that underestimate cumulative impacts and overestimates mitigations in the development plans. Thank you.
Dom, followed by Richard, followed by Steve Lay.
Hi, my name is Dom Forbush. That's Foxtrot, Oscar, Romeo, Bravo, Uniform, Sierra Hotel. I'm here to talk about the University of Washington Climbing Rock, which is down on the very southeast corner of campus across from the stadium. It's not on any of the maps you'll see outside, which is in itself a problem. And if you look at alternative number two, there's a big old unidentified building sitting right on top of it. That climbing rock is of great both historical importance and importance to the climbing community today. It was built in 1974. It's one of the first climbing rocks on the West Coast, that's outdoors at least. And a lot of the great Pacific Northwest mountaineers cut their teeth learning to climb on that rock. And it's still very actively used by an incredibly diverse community of climbers around the university. And with the university's mission over the last few years seeming to be increasingly driven towards like building communities, particularly diverse communities, it seems incredibly counterintuitive to me that as part of this master plan, they're thinking about demolishing a structure that has a community like that already existent around it. Just yesterday, we put up a petition on change.org to save the climbing rock, and might be updated in the last couple minutes, but last I checked, we have 737 signatures on that just in the last, like I said, 36 hours or so. So that's, I guess, what I have to say. Thank you for your time. Please save the rock if you can.
Richard, followed by Steve, followed by Casey Colvin.
Hello, my name is Richard Ellison, E-L-L-I-S-O-N. I live at 8003 28th Avenue Northeast, Seattle, Washington. First came to Seattle in 1981 as a university tech at the University of Washington, research technician, and discovered the University of Washington climbing rock. It has become near and dear to my heart and many other people. And so as Dominic has stated that we started a petition yesterday, we have over 722 signatures in, you know, just starting it from yesterday. There's a tremendous support within the climbing community. Looking at the master plan, the University of Washington climbing rock is not mentioned one time throughout the whole document. You cannot find it listed on any map. So here you have something that's highly utilized by the not only the UW climbing community. It was started by the UW Climbing Club, and it was supported and built by ASWSU funds, and was constructed in 1974. I urge you to preserve this thing. It deserves landmark status. The climbing rock has tremendous support again from the community. The petition is being submitted automatically, so I thank you for that. I need to cover a second topic, so I'm going to switch hats here, and I need to talk about the master plan in regards to tree preservation. The master plan is proposing to exempt itself from the City of Seattle tree ordinance. This is wrong. The master plan is saying that it will implement its own strategy to exceed the city tree ordinance standards, but it doesn't say what those standards or what it would be. Unfortunately, most recently, to show how the university is doing things, it has built some new large student housings, and as part of that process in the Northeast campus of replacing McCarthy and Haggett Hall, they were permitted to remove 220 large trees, including 90 trees that met the exceptional tree status under the City of Seattle laws.
it's imperative that the plan should include not only what details it will do to preserve trees under construction projects, but it should also, because it has the capability, it can produce a map that shows all the trees that are at risk of being cut down in development. The university states that it now has basically an online GIS type mapping that talks about the species, the size, the health of that tree. And they can therefore create a map that shows every tree that's at risk from every structure and project that they would like to do at the University of Washington in the next 10 years and in the full build out plan. This is something that they're capable of doing and should be included. It should be a list of the trees to be lost. It should be a map of the trees that would be at lost. It needs to be spelled out. Thank you very much.
Steve, followed by Casey, followed by Amy Ono.
Hi, my name is Steve Lee. I live at 912 17th Avenue in Seattle. I work here in the UW Tower on the 15th floor. I'm also a member of Service Employees Union, the lead steward for West Campus. I just want to say very bluntly that it's time for you to go back to the drawing board. This plan will not work. There is no real consideration for the human factor involved in this. This plan makes the housing crisis worse. It drives out low-income housing, low-income people from the area, students, staff, etc. It makes a bad commute worse with no provision for transit. It makes the childcare crisis work. Already, people cannot get childcare through the university. Very few people can. We need a massive plan for childcare in this area, and you're going to bring another 10 or 15,000 people onto the campus and not provide for childcare. It just doesn't make any sense at all. The bottom line of a public university should not be the bottom line. It ought to be, you ought to consider the social factor. The University of Washington is a rich institution. Apparently, it's very rich if it can build this whole new master plan, and if it has that kind of money, then let's put some of it into people. The university right now has refused to really seriously consider raising the wages of low-income workers on the campus. And yet, they're going to create a situation which makes those low-income workers commute longer hours and have more stress and so forth. This is just not going to work. Just as a personal note, I started working at the University of Washington in 1981. At that time, me and my wife could afford a really decent house in the central area, a very short commute from the University of Washington. Today, if we tried to do that, if we were just starting in the workforce, there is no way that we could do that on the salaries that we get at the University of Washington. The University of Washington is a major institution and needs to take some social responsibility. It has all this money. Let's use it for people. Go back to the drawing board and come up with a decent plan.
Casey, followed by Amy, followed by Thomas Schaefer.
Good evening. My name is Casey Colvin. That's C-O-L-V-S and Victor I-N. I live at 4225 9th Avenue Northeast, number 24, Seattle, Washington. And I'm here today because I wanted to talk about two points with regards to the growth plan that was proposed. The first point that I would like to make is that I feel like I am blessed and in a lucky and fortunate situation in that I am able to walk to work 15 minutes back and forth from my office to my home. And I kind of get the sense that a lot of people would consider this sort of like a luxury, but I really don't believe that it should be a luxury. And, you know, with regards to this growth plan, you know, I'm not categorically opposed to growth. I think growth can be a good thing, but we need to make sure that we have a plan and that the university uses its political clout, because it is able to do so, to make sure that the development plans on campus and also outside of the immediate campus in the immediate neighborhood are designed in such a way to aid the people who work and live near the University of Washington. So principally talking about affordable housing. So I would want that the university find and explore ways in order to make this be possible. I know that the university will have to negotiate with the city with regards to the zoning ordinance. Some of the ideas I would think about would be perhaps the university look into providing housing for its employees, or at an affordable rate, or perhaps working towards policies that would give favorable housing choices and opportunities and rates for university employees. I know that the private sector already does this on their own for the benefit of employees at, say, Amazon.com. So some advantages of being able to do this, especially to make sure that university staff and faculty can live close to the neighborhood, would be reduced traffic, reduced pollution, less crowded transit, better quality of life, and would also have an indirect positive impact on the city and region as a whole. So I would strongly ask that the University of Washington please consider and ways to improve the housing situation for the people that work at its institution. My second point, and which addresses the development plans of the proposal more specifically, I did notice that there are proposals to redo the buildings at the site of Padelford Hall, which is where I currently work. As somebody who's worked in Padelford Hall since January of 2015, when I started working at the Department of Spanish and Portuguese Studies, let me tell you that Padelford Hall is probably the second most hated building on campus. It is full of asbestos, it is a maintenance pit, and people hate visiting it. It is a nightmare to travel through. So I would like to conclude my statement by saying, please tear down Padelford Hall. Thank you.
Amy, followed by Thomas, followed by Vicki Clark.
Okay, my name is Amy Ono. Last name's O-N-O, like Yoko. I live on 3606 Northeast 41st Street in Seattle. I'm pretty much not going to read what I wrote because people have brought up a lot bigger points and a lot more important things. I am here to talk about the parking and the traffic. I do live near UW, and I'm very fortunate that I live near UW. I don't work near UW, so while a lot of you are commuting in, I am trying to commute out. And I do have childcare, so I have very set hours of when I can be away from my child. So traffic really does concern me. I love the idea of the growth. It looks like there may even be growth in some of the housing, some of the grad student housing near our neighborhood, as well as possibly at the Horticultural Center, which we love to go to with my daughter. But you know, that will only continue to increase the traffic. So, to what a lot of people here said, I would be very curious to know kind of how we would solve Montlake, which is just a disaster. But parking is another issue. We are the closest neighborhood to UW that does not have an RPZ. We would love an RPZ. We would love help getting an RPZ. And I was at a meeting here last week, and I heard some of the stats that said, you know, the number of students and faculty and staff parking at UW has gone down over the last several years, especially since rates increased. And I would say that is probably true, but that's not because people aren't still driving. They are driving. They just aren't able to afford the parking on campus. So they're parking in front of our house and in front of our neighbors' houses. I get that. I don't like paying for parking in downtown Seattle either. But then it affects us. So when I come home with my toddler who's screaming and all that, I don't have anywhere to park in front of my house. So I would encourage UW to look for other solutions in addition to the actual transportation issue. I have worked for Microsoft before, I don't now, but they have the shuttles. You know, a lot of companies give away the passes, or they, rather than raising the price of the parking, for the employees and students and faculty coming, they're helping to subsidize it so that the employees that do have to drive and do have to leave at certain times actually have an affordable place to park. So I think it's probably a very small thing, but I would be asking for the, you know, the group's help in, you know, protecting where we park and where we drive, but also making it a little bit more affordable and accommodating for the people that need to go to UW every day. Thank you.
Thomas, followed by Vicki, followed by Guerlaire Pasunto. Sorry.
Hi, my name is Thomas Schaefer. That's S-C-H-A-E-F-E-R. I live at 4725 15th Avenue Northeast, which is just about as close to the UW campus as one can live without living on campus. I am an alum of the University of Washington. I have been faculty at UW. I'm currently staff at UW. I'm also a 37-year resident of the University District. Anybody else here been here that long? A few. And in fact, throughout that time, I've lived within 1/2 mile of the University of Washington main campus. My current residence is the Wayfarer Cooperative. I have lived there for 23 years. I've been the president of the co-op for more than 15 years. It's a 32-unit building built in 1923, older than the vast majority of the buildings on the University of Washington campus. I am very grateful to be able to be a homeowner in the University District, and in fact, this is, at this point, really the only way I can afford to continue living in Seattle, and my hope is to continue to be able to live there for the rest of my life. But currently, that dream is threatened. More than ever before, the mantra of the City of Seattle government and the University of Washington seems to be, growth is good, and beyond that, all growth is always good. At present, and since 1923, the building I live in is the largest residential structure in our block, but that's not going to be the case much longer, because the Seattle City Council, over the strongly worded recommendation of the hearing examiner, granted an upzone for our block to build a much larger building in our block. The current proposed campus master plan to me is just breathtaking, that we have the no action alternative paired with 5 alternatives that are all 6 million square feet of building. We go from 0 to 6 million in 0 seconds. That doesn't seem to make any sense to me at all. I don't understand why there aren't any intermediate alternatives that are perhaps more sustainable, that being a well-regarded word at the University of Washington these days. I would like for the University of Washington to think, for the planners in charge of this master plan, to think about the fact that the University of Washington exists within a neighborhood that is home to many people, and that driving people out of their homes is unjust. And I didn't arrange for the lights to go out. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Dark up here. A few more lights up here, if possible.
Shall I go?
All right, Vicki, are you okay there in the
dark?
Sure.
Yeah, sorry.
Okay. Vicki, followed by Johnny, and followed by Abby Lawler.
Good evening, Vicki Clark, C-L-A-R-K-E. I'm here on behalf of Cascade Bicycle Club. My home address for the record is 8701 35th Avenue Northeast, Seattle 98115. The University of Washington has long been a leader in sustainable transportation planning. The university must continue working to ensure that the active transportation connections and connections to transit grow as the campus grows. With 2 new light rail stations within the near future in close proximity to the university, the UW will see many more pedestrians and people on bikes accessing transit on or adjacent to campus. Safe, comfortable connections are important. Relatedly, Cascade and our transit advocacy partners also strongly support efforts by the university to fund a financially sustainable, to find a financially sustainable path forward for the UPass. The Burke-Gilman Trail is an especially important connection both to and through the university campus. Retaining this off-road trail in its entirety as a major route through campus is important. Active transportation routes like the Burke that feel safe for users of all ability and comfort levels are essential to the university meeting its goals of the Transportation Master Plan and the Climate Change Action Plans. Thank you for your time. Cascade Bicycle Club plans to submit detailed comments in the EIS in writing.
Thank you.
Guiller Assunto. Followed by Abby Lawler and Dale Bright.
That's G-I-U-L-I-A. Last name is P-A-S-C-I-U-T-O. Good evening, my name is Julia Pasciuto and I'm a policy analyst for Puget Sound Sage. We're a coalition of community, labor, and faith organizations and use strategic research, policy advocacy, and organizing to build communities where all family thrive. We are an organization that's committed to racial and social justice, which is why I'm here tonight to speak to our concerns over the UW campus expansion, specifically the impact on housing affordability, displacement, and the undocumented impact on University of Washington workers. We're deeply concerned this expansion plan will make housing and other costs more expensive for low-wage workers and students, but the plan neither acknowledges this nor makes any attempt to mitigate these impacts. Specifically, there's been no analysis of the housing displacement impact of the expansion plan, either the physical, meaning the demolition of existing affordable units, or economic, the imminent rent increases in the neighborhood, even though the U District and other neighborhoods are already at high risk of displacement. Given this, it's not credible for the EIS to say that there's no significant housing impact. We have additional concerns that the master plan will foster the displacement of residents from the U District and that the new light rail station will facilitate and further exacerbate existing displacement risk in the Rainier Valley. The campus expansion will benefit the university's bottom line, the tech companies and their employees who can afford higher rents in the newly constructed buildings, but low and middle wage workers at the UW and students facing higher housing prices will be forced to live further distances and they'll lose out. Specifically, the university is not providing adequate affordable housing, childcare, or transportation options for many of its current staff and students. This will only exacerbate our housing and childcare affordability and accessibility crisis and undermine our city's transit goals. The UW must correctly assess its impact on the surrounding community in the EIS and the master plan and must address the concerns of its workers and neighborhood residents prior to adopting the expansion. Thank you.
Abby, followed by Dale, followed by Shirley Nixon.
Abby Lawler, L-A-W-L-O-R. I reside at 6108 48th Avenue South. I'm here tonight with Unite Here Local 8, the Hotel and Hospitality Workers Union in Seattle, and we're here as a part of the U District Alliance to echo the call for UW development that address the needs of students, workers on and off campus, and the broader Seattle community. Our union represents 5,000 largely low-wage workers. We're concerned by the university's approach to development through the campus master plan and the U District upzone on two levels. First, this development will exacerbate our members' existing struggles to find and maintain affordable housing and viable transit options in the Seattle region. Second, this development will spur the creation of new low-wage hospitality jobs as additional services locate in the U District to cater to the UW's growing campus. Any additional growth in the campus master plan must acknowledge the rapidly increasing costs for low-wage workers of living and commuting in the Seattle area, in particular in the areas around the university and around light rail. These increased costs are not peripheral to the growth of the UW, they're a direct result of it. Adequate mitigation is necessary from an environmental impact perspective, but also in keeping with the university's commitments to racial and economic justice. The failure of university-affiliated development to fully acknowledge and mitigate environmental impacts, and in particular housing impacts, is familiar to our union through our work advocating for responsible development on the UW-owned Metropolitan Tract in downtown Seattle. The university leases land for one hotel on the Metro Tract, and another is proposed and permitted. In anticipation of this new project, the university negotiated a deal with the city which resulted in a $15 million reduction in the project's affordable housing contribution. Resources for affordable housing in our city are too precious to let slip away, and our union appealed the project's master use permit and the adequacy of the accompanying EIS in order to try and recoup some of those lost funds. In June of this year, a city hearing examiner agreed that the university's development partner, Wright-Runstad, failed to adequately disclose the project's housing impacts. Though the applicant argued a case may not be remanded under SEPA for failure to analyze economic, quote-unquote, non-environmental issues, the hearing examiner ruled that there's authority to the contrary. Unfortunately, the EIS before us tonight shows the university erring in a similar fashion on the campus master plan. It's simply not credible or sufficient to state that significant housing impacts would not be anticipated by this proposal, nor is it adequate to look narrowly at the master plan and ignore the cumulative impacts with the upzone. Development on the UW campus and the surrounding U District must be better than what we've seen downtown, and that starts with adequate assessment of the environmental impacts of campus growth through the EIS. Thank you.
Dale, followed by Shirley, followed by Rona Ding.
Good evening, my name is Dale Bright. I'm here as the president of the Martin Luther King County Labor Council in support of the U District Alliance for an Equitable and Livable Community. I'm amazed to hear the testimony of workers and students at the University of Washington, the lack of housing, childcare, and transit. The university needs to rethink the master plan and develop it through the lens of social equity and compassion. My other job is I'm the political director for Labor's Local 242. And one of our hallmark things we did in the last 5 years has helped develop the priority hire program in the city of Seattle. Gives the city of Seattle an opportunity to create opportunity for local workers on these projects. These construction projects are great places to develop careers in the building trades. I'd ask the University of Washington as they go forward with this build out to look at developing a community workforce agreement or priority hire program that's similar to the city of Seattle so we can give opportunity to community members to have access to careers in the building trades. Thank you. Right,
B-R-I-G-H-T. Shirley, followed by Rona, followed by Corey Crocker.
Good evening, my name is Shirley Nixon. I live at 4548th Avenue Northeast, apartment 2305 at the University Plaza Condominiums, overlooking much of the campus. And what I'd like to do before I begin is I have a couple of pictures to turn in, and I want to congratulate everybody for what they've said so far. I'm kind of tossing out a lot of my prepared remarks because you will be getting some written statements. But it's interesting that one of the pictures that I wanted to submit tonight had something to do with shadows, and the professor that talked about the importance of shading things. I have a picture taken from the top of University Plaza looking toward the UW Tower and campus. At about 7 p.m. on June 16th, 2014, and the UW Tower completely shades the law building, and it goes on into the campus. The Decca Hotel, of course, shades some things, and of course, University Plaza shades some things, including the bridges, which are housing that were being built at the time. But I'd like to point out, too, that this was 7 p.m. on June 16th, not pretty close to the longest day of the year, so there were still a couple more hours of shadows on this nice bright day that we're going to be shading things. So we shouldn't minimize the amount of shadows. Another picture that I'd like to submit is actually just a picture taken of the campus kind of toward the UW Medical Center and so forth, just to show what it looked like on March of 2015. There's a view of Mount Rainier and so on, and a lot of lower rise buildings. And even though there are a few shadows at that point, the lower rise buildings are not necessarily shading things. And then the last picture I have is of the new UW Co-Motion building that is being leased by the UW at 4545 Roosevelt. It was a build to suit the UW, and the UW leases a lot of things, and the campus master plan just really doesn't talk very much about all of the off-campus leasing that happens, but my reading of the campus plan seems to detect, and maybe it's just me, but I kind of detected this threat of, if you don't let us build all of this $6 million square feet or gross square feet that we want to do in the next 10 years, we'll just go and find the lease structure and we're going to take over the U District anyway. So anyway, I'd like to turn those in. I'm going to skip around here because I did read the campus master plan and I tried to read a lot of the EIS, and I only have 30 seconds. So I want to say that to approve the campus master plan is to endorse the philosophy that it is better to demolish than preserve. I'm shocked at the amount of demolition of existing buildings that haven't been maintained, or I don't know why a 40-year-old building would be slated to be demolished, but it's certainly in there, and there's like 2.2 5 million GSF that are planning to be demolished, and that's how you get to the net 6 million, because really they want to build 9 million and they take away that much and they get to 6 million. So the net, it includes an awful lot of demolition of existing buildings.
Time.
Thank you for accepting the comments, and you'll be getting some written ones.
Thank you.
Should I turn these in to you? Okay, thank you.
Rona, followed by Corey, followed by James.
Yeah. My name's Rona Ding, R-O-N-A-D-I-N-G, and I live at 500 438th Avenue Northeast. I wanted to thank everyone for their advocacy. I'm totally blown away for everyone's pleas about childcare, transit, trees, housing. I personally would be eternally grateful if someone solved the traffic on Montlake or tore down Bedelford. But I am here to draw attention to the UW Rock as well. Again, it's a concrete outdoor climbing rock that was built in the 1970s, and it's one of the first public outdoor climbing rocks on the West Coast, if not the country. So I went to undergrad here, and I'm currently a second year medical student. So I've been at UW and have been climbing this rock for 7 years now, which I know is nothing compared to Richard and some of the other guys and their experience with the rock. And I know that UW, we're known for football and we're a world-class university, but I just wanted to say, don't forget about us climbers. As an undergrad, I was a treasurer for the climbing club. As a medical student, I'm part of the Wilderness Medicine Interest Group. Climbing, being in the outdoors, hiking, it's a part of Pacific Northwest culture. From people who hike Mount Si to people who climb Mount Rainier, through climbing, people get physical activity, they get stress relief. I've built confidence as a strong female climber. I've gotten to experience nature, and I've also watched so many other of my peers and classmates experience the same thing. The UW climbing rock is free, which is great for undergrads and medical students, as you know, climbing at some of the gyms in Seattle can be up to like $70 a month or more. It's a rock that bonds generations. I mean, I've been taught how to climb on the rock. I've taught other people to be on the rock. When I met Richard through this advocacy for the UW rock, he said he knew the engineer who worked on the rock. And I just want to say also, you know, I've spent many a sunny afternoon on the rock, but don't underestimate climbers. Even when it's cloudy or it's rainy, the second it dries, people are out there. And so I again would like to state for the record that I also support the UW rock getting landmark status. And would like everyone to keep this in mind when looking at the campus master plan, because it is not listed anywhere. Thanks so much.
Corey, followed by James.
So my name is Corey Crocker, and I live at Roosevelt and 43rd. Sorry. Oh yeah, Crocker, C-R-O-C-K-E-R. Thank you. So with the concurrent campus master plan and the U-District rezone of our combined communities, we have the opportunity to grow together in a consistent and symbiotic way for the benefit of all stakeholders. So I want to give kudos to the campus master plan's alternative one, which leverages higher buildings, with more publicly accessible open space, where alternative two loses much of that open space if existing zoning is adopted. In contrast, the U-District rezone proposes higher buildings without adequate public open space, and I think the city could learn quite a bit from your progressive efforts. Now, there is some room for improvement. After much community input and some contention, the proposed U-District rezone caps buildings at 85 feet along the Ave with its unusually long and narrow blocks, so it is out of character to have buildings on the Ave abruptly jump three times in height to the proposed 240 feet in the West Campus area. For example, in the plans, Schmitz Hall along the Ave could be redeveloped at 240 feet. So the UW should observe the same height caps along the Ave that our community wants. Thank you.
Thank you. And James.
My name is James Mattei, and that's M-A-T-T-H-A-E-I, and I live at 4100 36th Avenue, Northeast, Seattle, Washington, and I'm a proud alumni of the university. I have three sets of questions, mainly. First, the master plan calls for traffic to remain at or below 1990 standards. And your measurement of this statistic, impact on outlying neighborhoods is not taken into account. As a graduate student, we were told by fellow students, staff, and faculty where we could park for free in the surrounding neighborhoods. Now living in these high-tech areas, I see students, faculty, and staff parking in the neighborhoods. This is a large amount of commuters that need to be taken into the statistics. With this expansion of UW, these numbers will only get worse. Or to put it simply, I do not believe you have accurately calculated the traffic statistics. Also, if you listen here tonight, you will hear most people having significant traffic issues and will only keep getting worse. Number two, expansion into the urban horticulture area. The master plan calls for a three-story academic building to be built. This area is very far from main campus and it'd be hard for students to actually walk to take a class. And does not make sense to have a building of this size there, as there is no building of this size in the area. This would highly impact wildlife there, and this is a true gem of UW. And the loss of this building, the loss of this area to a building of unknown function would be a shame and could also hurt the wildlife. And finally, three, overall south expansion. The unprecedented growth to South Campus will dramatically impact the traffic and the wildlife in the area. I have not read how you plan to have this massive expansion and increase in people in this area while keeping traffic, the fields of the neighborhoods, and wildlife the same. I was very disappointed in coming to a meeting last week and talking with different planners who could not explain this to me. I knew the proposed building limits better than they did. After talking with three different planners, it seemed to me that UW was just trying to maximize growth in this area with no thought to what would actually go in these buildings. Please think about the expansion and what UW actually wants to build and where it wants to grow as a university. Thank you.
Are there any other speakers? Okay, well, we'll keep the record open. Okay, sure, come on.
My name is Anya McMurr, it's A-N-Y-A. The last name is M-C-M-U-R-R-E-R. So my name is Ani McMurr. I'm on the organizing staff at the Church Council of Greater Seattle, which is an organization comprised of over 300 congregations dedicated to working towards the common good for communities in suffering. Our concern regards the increased housing costs in the U District as a direct result of the expansion, causing more displacement of low-income UW workers and students than would otherwise occur. As it now stands, light rail has made it far easier to commute from Rainier Valley. It will thus increase competition for affordable housing in Southeast Seattle and other neighborhoods already at high risk for displacement. The social impact on current and future low-income residents in the U District will be substantial and requires further scrutiny. There needs to be a goal for mitigation of the loss of housing and building, in addition to a one-to-one replacement of lost units. Please consider this. Thank you very much.
Is there anyone else who wishes to speak? Yes.
Hello, my name is Sean Williams, W-I-L-L-I-A-M-S. I just want to thank everybody for being here and thanking them for putting this on. It's great that we have the public getting out here speaking about their concerns.
And it was really great to hear everybody's concerns and the social equity challenges that not only UW, but our entire city community is dealing with. I think people have brought up really important issues that the UW should represent and provide the means to take the initiative to make changes that address these social issues. I think UW also has an opportunity to invest in a lot of renewable energy, and the UW does an amazing job of being a very efficient school with its energy, and I think the plan has put out some great stuff for open space, but I'd like to see also use of solar panels, geothermal investments, maybe wind investments, and be an experiment, be a research facility, and put it onto these new developments. I think Seattle has opportunity to utilize our developments to really make ourselves a clean city. And I think the UW would be a great opportunity for that. I know UW does a lot. I just would like to emphasize that putting more in is always better. But then again, thank you for everybody coming here. It's really great to see how many people came out.
Sure.
Hi, everybody. My name is Alex Brunner. That's B as in Bravo, R as in Robert, O, N as in Nancy, E-R. And I didn't intend to come here today, but a friend couldn't make it and asked me to go instead. So not knowing much about this issue except for reading through the AIS real quick, I'll keep it brief. I want to mention that I am with a nonprofit called Housing Now Seattle, and we've been working on expanding publicly financed housing. And creating affordable housing that's new housing is extremely challenging. It's primarily a budget issue, really. And so I just want to encourage those who've spoken to the issue of affordable housing to not stop advocating for it at the EIS, that really this is a budget fight, not primarily a design issue, but a matter of, you know, putting together the money, putting together the subsidies to make it happen. So I appreciate your passion for affordability and for affordable housing, and I hope to see you coming out to those budget fights at the city level and, you know, through various avenues of the university. Thank you.
Is there anyone else who'd like to speak? We will leave the record open until 9 o'clock, so if anybody does want to speak, come on up, we'll stay up here. That's about 25 more minutes. So I want to thank everybody for coming and giving us their comments. Thank you.